there was no voice, there was no framework that would really talk about extension and advisory services. There were no synergies. Each country was doing a very good thing, but you couldn't learn, we couldn't even work together.
Since its launch in May 2011, the institution works towards achieving its mission of ensuring quality agriculture extension services and effectively contributing to agriculture development in Uganda. It's against the background that UFAAS organized a workshop to bring together a broad range of actors to take stock of the current critical issues affecting agriculture extension and advisory services. It was a heated debate as the second annual workshop opened. Presenters and participants echoed their disappointment over government prioritizing distribution of agriculture inputs and according low value to agriculture extension services. The two-day conference that was held from 29th to 30th October 2014 at Grand Imperial Hotel in Kampala ran on the theme, Uganda's Agriculture at Crossroads, Critical Issues in the Extension and Advisory Services System. The meeting opened with welcome remarks from the first chairperson of us, Mr. Augustine Mwendia.
On behalf of the Uganda Forum for Agriculture Advisory Services Executive Committee, we welcome you all this year's stakeholders workshop.
The warm welcome was followed by an address by the minister that was delivered by Mr. Okasai Opalot, the Commissioner of Crop Resources, who addressed fears of the participants in regard to agriculture extension. He cleared the air on what was going on with the reforms in the National Agriculture Advisory Services.
The reform is about bringing the two public extension systems, making it one, and establishing a formidable coordination of the extension services in the country. And it should not be misconstrued to mean we are going to have only public servants providing extension.
He further assured that reforms fully recognize other players in the agriculture extension services.
The reform will look at the industry as a source of provision of extension, farmer associations as extension workers, producers themselves as extension workers, academia, training institutions provide extension.
Mr. Okasai, however, admits that agriculture development is a multi-dimensional approach.
The reforms emphasize having the farmer as a centerpiece. What we want to bring now the generators of technologies, generators of knowledge into a common pool and strengthen the linkages between research and extension.
He assured of continued support by the ministry.
The ministry embraces UFAAS as a body that brings the extension workers together. It provides now a face which the ministry can use to bring this thing into the extension and delivery of advisory services. The ministry will also continue to support efforts in capacity building of human resource requirements to offer agricultural extension and advisory services.
The minister's speech was followed by a presentation from Dr. Margaret Nejiko, the chairperson of Uganda Forum for Agriculture and Advisory Services, and now the gloves were off.
If we are to dream big, we also must be able to act big in a very focused and serious manner.
Dr. Nejiko stressed the importance of agriculture extension services for development of the industry.
The challenges that are facing Uganda's agriculture are actually enormous.
Without any omissions, she continued to give a full account of critical issues in agriculture extension.
Agriculture extension services actually play a key role. However, currently, agriculture extension is accorded low value because policymakers and politicians are prioritizing mere distribution of agriculture inputs over and above development of farmer capacity for innovation and appropriate use of improved inputs and other technologies. There was disbanding of the NAD structure at the district and sub-county levels, and all staff at those levels have been laid off. That means the NAGS coordinators and the private service providers.
In one of her recommendations, Dr. Najingo asked the Ministry of Agriculture to spell out clear implementation manuals.
It is not clear how the key institutions will relate to each other to achieve the desired outcome. So our concern is we don't see any integrated and systematic and focused manner in implementing these reforms. As stakeholders, we haven't seen an official strategy document and operational guidelines that guide the country on the approach that we are going to take. And we feel that approaches, strategies, and roles and implementation guidelines are actually not clear.
She finally warned her past speech with strong conclusive remarks.
The new agriculture extension approach that the reform envisages to use should be spelled out clearly by Naive. We want to see clear guidelines on, in manuals for what to guide the actors, what will their roles be, and the capacities that are required for them to be able to perform the envisaged roles. We feel, given the issues we've articulated above, that aquatic extensions are across at crossroads, actually in a crisis, and the implications are going to be negative, both now but more importantly in the near future and beyond.
Her presentation ignited an intense debate in a discussion that followed.
I want to disagree with my colleague who said that the reason the government came in to give inputs is because people who had been, capacity built, had no way of putting that skill into real practice. But I want to say that if I can get something free, why should I then buy it? These people knew that actually if government can be put in a position to give to them, then why should they bother to go and buy elsewhere? To me, I think Uganda is taking free things too far, giving everything free, everything free, everything free, and people are getting used now to this free thing.
In the interim period, as we look at the outcome of these reforms, the farmer is left with no option but to grapple with whatever source of information.
Don't you think we are much better off building the capacity of these people and asking them to get the inputs themselves?
We are wondering, are we really trying to give this country the best that our resources can provide, or we are just taking farmers for a ride?
All the issues being presented here, they are very smart and very clear. I support them 100%.
Our presentation targeted to address the theme of the workshop. Mr. Tom Kakuba from Plan for Modernization of Agriculture gave an update in the efforts to introduce the National Agriculture Policy.
In 2012, the Minister of Agriculture submitted the policy, the draft to Cabinet, and on 25th September last year, Cabinet approved this one.
What is the rationale for an agriculture policy now?
There was a lot of stakeholder demand. Sometimes the demands were expressed softly, in other cases it came in other different forms. Then there is the constitutional obligation, but also to guide investment, not only by government, but others like the private sector. We know civil society also makes some investments in agriculture and others.
Mr. Tom Kakuba adds that for the policy to work with the Ministry of Agriculture, Animal Industry and Fisheries should make adjustments.
The government must establish or operationalize an agriculture service delivery system with optimal structures and capacities at all levels. The ministry must be able to be on top of its own agencies.
When the policy draft was being presented here, I listened carefully and I was very concerned when areas of funding was not mentioned.
Towards the end of the first day of the workshop, key sector representatives presented a declaration to the media in a press briefing and maintained that a lot needs to be fixed.
Agriculture currently is at crossroads. And I say so because the current arrangement in the Ministry of Agriculture as regards extension is almost non-existent.
With the non-existence of the extension system, that means that the delivery of services to the farmers has greatly reduced.
The situation is made worse in those districts where the bulk of the service providers under TAS in NADS were originally the traditional extension work.
The main issue is not actually distributing aquaculture inputs. Extension goes beyond inputs. It is organizing the farmers, training them, providing them with the necessary knowledge, information, skills, and the technologies. With the lack of the extension service in place, I feel that it is a fact that agriculture is at crossroads.
Where do we go? Where do the farmers know where they are going? Do the extension workers know where they are going?
Professor Finas Tukamhabwa, an expert in plant breeding from Makerere University, discussed the development of biotechnology as a remedy to some of the challenges in aquaculture.
It is a great innovation. However, one has to put into consideration who are the end users. You have to work with the end users to find out what they want. Utilizing genetically modified crops could be one of the ways in which we are going to help our ever-increasing population. However, I'm not saying it is a must, and it should be one of the ways, and it should be adopted with the agreement of everybody. The masses need to be taught about this so that they are also in agreement. But to me, if the masses say that they don't want GMOs, just leave them alone. For people who promote GMOs, the researchers and any other group, it is better to use participatory approaches. You ask people what they like and what they don't like.
The workshop provided an opportunity for participants to echo their recommendations for a better future of extension services.
The main issue is not actually distributing aquaculture inputs. Extension goes beyond inputs. It is organizing the farmers, training them, providing them with the necessary knowledge, information, skills, and the technologies.
The speed that we have used to introduce these reforms is really a very high one, supersonic. I wish the reforms were introduced in phases.
If this trend does not improve, 3-4 years from now, we may have a food insecurity in the country because people will not have fertile soils because they've over-exhausted the soils. So there will be no extension services provided on what they should do because most of our population is illiterate, so people need information from time to time.
On the second day of the workshop, UFAAS held its second annual general meeting.
I declare that we have started the second annual general meeting.
The workshop was crowned with the awarding of certificates to participants at the official closing, presided over by the Executive Director, African Forum for Agriculture Advisory Services, Dr. Salim Nadi.
Yeah. And with this really let me close the workshop, but also open the chapter of venturing us out of the formative stages of the country forum into really active participation.
The workshop was made possible with funding from IFAD and co-sponsored by Aircraft. There was evidence that UFAAS should continuously advocate for the value and relevance of agriculture extension and advisory services and continue to build capacity of its members to be up to date with emerging issues and approaches. UFAAS should lead in setting standards for the extension and advisory services in Uganda and advocate for their adoption by the Uganda's Ministry of Agriculture, Animal Industry and Fisheries.